All right, says it's working. We're going to start the service today with the 110th Psalm, one of the most quoted psalms, maybe the most quoted psalm in the New Testament. This is the Psalm of David. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord shall send the rod of your strength out of Zion, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people shall be volunteers in the day of your power. In the beauty of holiness, from the womb of the morning, you have the dew of your youth. The Lord has sworn and will not relent. You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He shall execute kings in the day of his wrath. He shall judge among the nations. He shall fill the places with dead bodies. He shall execute the heads of many countries. He shall drink of the brook by the wayside. Therefore, he shall lift up the head. Wonderful stuff there. Okay, today we have somebody to open us named, and I may say his name wrong because I haven't heard it pronounced, but Sagalo. Okay. Bruce Sagalo is here to speak about something. I'll let him introduce himself. I'll let him tell all about that, and we'll just welcome you, good sir. Come on up. And you'll see there's a box right here. You want to make sure you're sitting low enough where, because you're kind of a tall guy, you can just make sure you're in there so the people that are watching online can see you. If you need to back up or something, whatever.
Yeah, back up a little. I'll just slouch. Thank you so much for having me here. It's a blessing to be among you. I'm here because a mutual friend of Charlie's and mine contacted Charlie and said, this man is coming to our country in Asia to present teaching and training for parents who have adopted children and are struggling with their adoptions. Now, there are many people who adopt children, thankfully, and don't struggle with that. Were you or did you?
Yes, two of them. Wonderful children, all grown up now.
Wonderful. Okay, so I don't want to be melodramatic and say that everybody that has a child that's been adopted has terrible times and difficulties. But for the percentage of people who do, the difficulties are amazing to me. And I want to just take a minute to tell you about my journey a little bit and how this calling came to me, because I really, people say, you know, how did you decide to do this? And I didn't decide to do this. So, although every day I decide to keep doing it. Let me start by saying that I grew up in a Jewish family, and I really, by the time I was about 18, I had just finished high school, and I wasn't sure what to do with my life. Even though I had been to Hebrew school after school and Sunday school and had been bar mitzvahed and then later confirmed after weekly meetings with my rabbi for a year, I still wasn't sure about God and things spiritual. And I was very fortunate that there's a song that many of you may know, You Gave Me Love When Nobody Gave Me a Prayer. My grandmother took me in when I was 16, and she exemplified giving me love when nobody gave me a prayer. And so I was, in that sense, a recipient of kinship care. And so I just finished high school, and I was wondering, all right, what do I do with my life? I hadn't applied to college. I would have been voted most likely to fail based on my focus in school in those days. And so I was thinking, what makes life really, I don't want to just go through the thing that's a typical pattern and end up with children who go through that typical pattern, and it seemed meaningless to me. So I spent the night, and I didn't know it at the time, but I think I was really spending the night in prayer. And I was being drawn, and I came to a conclusion after the sun rose that the only thing that made life really of value was to live a life of love. And I committed myself to doing that without a clue what I was in for. So I was 18, I had some clarity. I then experienced what probably could be called a season of conviction, because I discovered that even though I wanted every interaction with each person I met to be loving, I wasn't able to pull it off. Some people didn't seem that lovable to me, or I was having a bad day, or whatever. But I then began to realize that I was in a crisis. The only thing that made life valuable was to live a life of love, and I couldn't do it. And it was at that point, and this will not surprise those of you here, that somebody asked me if I had a relationship with God, and I said, no. And a couple that had taken me into their home asked me if I'd ever read the New Testament. And I was so proud of myself that I was an extremely well-read person for my age. And so embarrassedly, I said, no, I haven't. They asked me if I'd be willing. And so before I went to sleep, I said what was probably the first very direct, conscious prayer I had said that was not by rote. And it was something to the effect of, dear God, if this New Testament is truth, please help me to see that. And if it's not, well, good night. So, you know, I wasn't very schooled in the ways of formal prayer, as you can tell. And I started reading the New Testament. And as a rabbi who'd become a Christian later wrote many years ago, beautifully, eloquently, he said, I was looking for thorns and I gathered roses. Mm. And that was my experience. And I was so profoundly moved, even as I, because I'm reading this and I don't know how it ends. And so, you know, by the time there's the crucifixion, there's plenty of foreshadowing about the possibility of a resurrection, but I don't know how this is going to turn out. So it's all very new to me. I went, and so I came to faith, and I trusted on September 14th, 1970. I still remember the time and place. So coming up on 47 years, you'd think I would be able to walk on water by now, but at least I thought I would by then, you know. And to speed things up a little bit, I did go back. That was out in California, and I went back to Massachusetts, in New England, where my family's from, and I felt very concerned because I really thought I was the only person, at least on the East Coast, that knew this. And so my first goal was to tell my friends and family about this faith, and some of them came to believe, including my grandmother. And my brother, and others that were very close, and some resisted, you know, for a long time, and I then found a sense of calling to at least tell the Jewish people in the Boston area about Jesus, because I thought I really didn't know that there were other people that believed this that were already out there. So that's how. Partly I wasn't open to hearing it. I'm sure there were people in my life all along, but I didn't recognize that. And I think they were probably sensitive to my energy of pushing that away anyway. Fast forward from that. So I spent 2 years as a missionary in the Boston area, preaching the gospel, going into colleges and speaking one-on-one into groups of students and so on. And then I started to do, I think, some of the real work of growing up and learning to live the life that I was being called to. I went to work in a factory. I went back and went to college and found out that now that my mind was clearer and my heart was clearer, I was actually a good student. And it amazed me. And all things new. And I was made new, and so were my study habits, which I discovered. And so the years went by, and I've done many things from then till now. But most recently, in the last 30 years, I've been a psychotherapist, and I've worked out of a church nearby, Gulf Gate Church, as some of you may know, and I've spoken in many other places, but I now have an office here in town. And about 10 years ago, I was finishing my doctoral dissertation, and I was trying to figure out a way to do a study that would be related to what my interest was, and my advisor, the chair of my committee, said, how about doing it on attachment and attachment theory? And I said, that's a great idea. And I said, what is attachment theory? And that began a journey of a 3-year research project and immersing myself in thinking that I was going to be doing this work with the adult couples, because I had a full practice at this point with adult couples that came to see me and individuals, because who couldn't improve their attachment relationships? And what started happening is two things. My therapist friends in town heard that I was studying attachment and started sending me families with children who were struggling with their adoption. And at the same time, my niece and nephew adopted a son. And so those things converged, and I started to see the struggles that all of those folks were having. Had my own struggles, and there's a diagnosis that's known as reactive attachment disorder. And it describes a lot of our kids who are struggling. And I actually think there's a diagnosis I made up. You won't find this anywhere else. But I call it reactivity to reactive attachment disorder, RRADD. And so I was having some of that. And so I started to look to see who's an expert in the area that can help me learn and mentor me. Couldn't find anybody. And I know a lot of folks in the area. And they all said there's nobody else. And then I started looking through the literature to see, you know, who were the people I respected the most, and I found some. I traveled to Maine and Pennsylvania and all sorts of places to get trained and mentored under supervision, and formed an organization out of my practice called Radical Play on Words, RAD for Reactive Attachment Disorder, Radical Healing. And in the process of doing that, we now have many people in the region that are coming. We have several therapists that are have been trained and supervised by me. And I was invited to go to Asia by somebody near and dear to Charlie and I, and that you may know. And I was invited to be the keynote speaker at a parenting conference that brings people, missionaries from all over Asia, particularly the wives of missionaries who are planting churches, and are the mothers of adopted children. So there's going to be between, I think, 300 and 400, maybe 450 people coming to this thing.
Wow.
And they're struggling so much with these relationships. Yep. I tell people that these are children who started life in an upside down way, so that they need to be parented in an upside down way. And I'll just take one more minute and tell you what I mean by parented it in an upside down way. Usually it's cause and effect seem to work pretty well for most of us who were raised under the that method, that if you do this, this will be the consequence if you do this. But for these children, a lot of times they haven't formed the clarity about cause and effect. To put it mildly, they're clueless. And so they can do something 100 times, have the same result. And I'll just give you a quick story. That nephew or great nephew that I mentioned, couple of years ago, and he's given me his permission to tell this part of his story. He was he borrowed a motorcycle from his close friend who allowed him to, so that was on the up and up. And he went out riding, and he got very scraped up. He got in a all by himself accident. And when I picked him up the next morning to take him out to breakfast and see how he was, he said, as we were walking to the car, he said, "Uncle Bruce," and he's got scrapes all over his arms and all over his face and chest, and he says, "Uncle Bruce, the funny thing is, you know, if I was drunk last night when all this happened," and he's very open, you know, no sense of shame or maybe not a sense of fear or insecurity in being able to share. So we've got that relationship. And he said, that's the good news. The bad news is no sense of being clear that one doesn't get drunk, A, and B, one doesn't get drunk and ride a motorcycle. And he says, if I had it to do all over again, I'd do the same thing. And I realized, oh my goodness, you know, how do I talk to him? And I had to slow myself down, because I have 100 things went through my mind, as you can imagine, such as, are you serious? You know, really? And but I calmed myself down first. And then I sat down with him about 15 minutes later when we got to the restaurant for breakfast. And he said, what are you thinking, Uncle Bruce? I can tell your wheels are spinning. And I said, I'm thinking there are two of you. There's one who is this lovely young man who works full-time in a restaurant, goes to school, is a joy and delight to be with. And there's the other one of you who is so lost and so trying to find your way. And I kind of stopped there. I've learned, you know, 40 words, that's as much as can be heard at one time. So I've said a lot more than that just now. And but I've learned, and he now lives with us, my wife and I, and so we have a chance to practice what we're teaching every day. And he's been a great teacher. He's got a ways to go. And we're going to have the opportunity now to go overseas and bring this message of what I call coming alongside gently. with these children. If you push them from behind, you'll knock them over. If you pull them from in front, they'll fall on you. Mm-hmm. So we come alongside gently, and I find a lot of the time the best thing I can do is be quiet. And, you know, I think of the verse, be still and know that I am God. That I've had to learn to practice that in a whole new way. And that's been a gift to me. And in time, words come or they don't come. But if I can get my own energy aligned with grace and with clarity, I'm able to be of some use. And that's what we're teaching parents to do. So thank you for having me here. I wanted to at least come in person and not just be somebody that asks for your help, but be somebody that shared with you who I am and what it is I'm about.
Now, before you get down, what are your exact needs so that we can...
Okay. Right now we have a need. We haven't booked the flight because we haven't had the money, and it's about $3,000 to get there and back. The rest of the need as far as food and transportation is covered. So that's in dollars. I thank you for asking. That's the exact number for our travel.
Good deal.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.